some papers. That would help, because nobody, you know, when these things break down, they set you, of course. Thank you so much for having me, like I said. I don't know where to start. I don't know. You know, when Margaret introduced me, she said a woman of caliber, and I'm thinking, okay, is that me? Is that somebody else she's talking about? But yes, I am a television presenter. I work on Ben Television, Sky 182. And what I primarily do there is about tourism. I'm a tourism ambassador, so I try to promote Africa and the Caribbean through tourism. I try to showcase the good parts about Africa so that we can have people that will come in and invest in all that. But a chance opportunity came up on radio for me to have a platform. And I thought, no, I'm not going to do tourism. I also have another forum for politics where we debate hot politics. It's called You Decide. I said, no, let me do something different. So I decided to go for women issues. I said, let me have a platform for women and see if women would call in. It was a Thursday afternoon. I wasn't expecting a lot of people to call in. The program was scheduled between 3 and 4 p.m. and I thought, oh, everybody will be doing school runs. Nobody's going to listen. But we did it a couple of times. It was a little bit quiet. And then the following weeks, it started picking up. And I realized that a lot of women had issues that they wanted to talk about, but there was nowhere for them to air their voices. And we started talking about, as the program went ahead, we went into more sensitive issues. We will talk about health issues like cancer. We will talk about widowhood. We will talk about domestic violence and abuse. So we started getting into sensitive topics. And I realized that most of my listeners, they would listen, but they wouldn't ask any questions. The phone line was open, and I would say, please call in, ladies, if you've got any concerns. And people would call in, and just maybe one or two callers, or they would call in, and they would not really want to discuss the topic that we were talking about. Meanwhile, I just wanted to use my platform of the media. Like, you know, Chris mentioned, if you have a talent and it's not being used, then it's going to rot away. So I thought, if I have this opportunity, if I have this platform, why not use it? So I decided, you know, let me just use my platform. I don't have a particular story to share. I can't tell you any juicy story and say, oh, you know, this is what happened to me. But the platform was there, the talent was there. So I said, okay, let's just put it to good use. So when I bring it, when we have the programs, I always make sure that I have an expert on the topic that we're talking about. Either somebody that has gone through that, or somebody that's, it's a professional, or someone that has a story to tell, so that they could back up that topic. It wouldn't just be me just talking. A lot of times the women would call in and then they would not own up to their stories. Hi, you okay? Remember we were at the Women Appreciating Women? Yes, I was one of the speakers. You're looking at me and I'm thinking, okay, she's remembering.
Of course.
So the women would not own up to their stories. A lot of them would say it happened to somebody else, because even for them it was a stigma to say that it was me. They couldn't own up to it. And a lot of times when they did want to own up to it, it would be weeks after we had discussed that. And then they would phone and say, you know the one about, you were talking about a domestic abuse, and you know, I just wanted to ask, how does one, and I'm like, okay, is that you? No, it's somebody else. Like, but I just want to find out for them, because my friend said she wanted it, and I'm like, can't your friend call you? No. And because I work on the television, I know that TV is very harsh, and we do a lot of live shows. Once you've said something, once your face has gone out there, that's it, you can't take it back. But with the radio, I was thinking, but this is radio. I mean, nobody knows you, nobody recognizes your voice, just say it. There was still that conspiracy of silence. People still did not want to own up to their stories because of the stigma of it happened to me. We are bogged down by religious and cultural factors, especially as women, that we're not allowed to talk about so many things. There's a conspiracy of silence, there's a taboo on some topics. Shh, don't talk about it, even when you can get help. For example, somebody, you know, undergoing issues with breast cancer, there are support groups. There's nothing wrong with you. It doesn't mean that you committed any sin. It doesn't mean that you're wrong in any way. It just happened that statistics, 3 in every, you know, 10 women would get this. And you just happen to be one of them. Own the story and deal with it. Get the help that is needed. But then there's still, you know, you go to, you know, your religious leader, or you go to your cultural leader or the community leader, and they say, don't tell anybody, no, we're going to fight this, we're going to pray about it, we're going to do this, but you know, don't let anybody hear. And probably if you share the story, there might be people that have gone through the same. Yeah. There might be people that have gone through it, there might be people that can point you in a direction where you can get help. A lot of people would leave it until it is late, and then when they go to see the doctors, they'll be told that, you know, it's terminal, well, sorry, there's nothing more we can do. Why didn't you come when you first discovered the lump? But no, my husband said I should know, my sister know, my pastor know, my imam, and it goes on and on. So I discovered that with that, a lot of women were suffering from things that they didn't need to suffer from. There was so much help around, but we are not harnessing it.
To access it.
So that was why I started the foundation, Voice of Hope for Women Foundation, which in itself is just a platform. It's a one-stop shop for women to just air their concerns, talk about what it is that you want to talk about. I tell them there's no topic that is taboo. Whatever you want to talk about, we have men come on the program, we talk about relationships, why do men cheat? And they will laugh because that's a lighter mood. You know, we don't want to bring in teenage pregnancies and very heavy topics every week. Sometimes we have a very light, you know, and people come in and they feel comfortable. But even then, all those salient points are still there underlying. We talked about mental health now. The gentleman shared before he left, you know, his worker, his colleague was going through stuff. There was nobody to talk to. A lot of people committing suicide, like the author said, you know, 50% rate adolescent is death is by suicide because people don't know who to talk to. You can't open up to anybody now. Like Margaret said, the community, we're losing that, you know, sense of togetherness. And it's in instances like this where you feel like a family that you can let out. Some people, they're going through so much, you will not believe it. And then they put up the makeup and they wear the suit and they're there, but then they do have issues. So that is what the Voice of Hope for Women Foundation is about, ladies and gentlemen. That's why I'm here. I've met Margaret on a couple of occasions. She's heard me speak, and I'm so privileged to be here. Oh.